Once upon a time, when the world was mostly ocean, wait, the world is mostly ocean right now. This was a time when the world was slightly more ocean. Yeah. There lived a beautiful goddess named Tefiti, whose heart held the power to create life. All was well until one day when she fell under a frightful enchantment after her heart was stolen by Dwayne "The Rock" Johnson. After 1,000 years passed, he brought it back with the help of some random little girl and a heroic chicken. Also the ocean, which was alive for some reason. After that, Tefiti hid her heart from the world in order to prevent its misuse, locking it away in a far-off tower, there to await the retrieval of the handsome Pappy G. It was he who would endure blistering winds and scorching deserts, traveling for many days and nights, risking life and limb to reach Tefiti's keep. For he was the bravest and most handsome in all the land, and it was destiny that his possession of the heart would bring harmony to the world. He alone would climb to the highest room of the tallest tower, enter the heart's chamber, cross the room to its ovalish silhouette, pull back the gossamer curtains to find—
Oh hey, what's up?
Are you Tefiti?
No.
Yeah, I don't even know why I asked that. Of course you aren't. Where's her heart?
Oh, we split it up into 12 pieces and we're all guarding a piece.
12 pieces? Oh, okay. And who's we?
We are the guardians of the heart pieces and top tier YouTubers.
So, your group is called Goth Patty?
Yep. Anyway, I doubt you could even get all the heart pieces. Only the Chosen One can do that.
Chosen One? Whom?
Oh hey, look at that. I have 1 million subscribers now. Huh.
You know what that means!
It means it's finally time to talk about Tamatoa for 1 hour, baby! You see, a couple of years ago, I said this.
However, he doesn't really fit with the theme of this video, so maybe I'll make an hour-long analysis about him one day.
See, that is what we in the YouTube community like to call hyperbole. I didn't intend to actually make that into a video, and if I did make the video, I didn't intend for it to be 1 hour long. But then you guys wouldn't stop messaging me about it, so eventually I had to throw my hands up in exasperation and say, okay, so we're doing this. Strap yourselves in, grab some popcorn. Hell, straight up just get dinner and bring it to your phone or computer or viewing device, I don't know. Even if it's too early for dinner, too bad, because you guys don't deserve to eat lunch in this town again after what you made me do. As you watch the following hour of content, just know that I didn't do it for you. I did it for him. At long last, I can finally explain what makes Tamatoa the greatest Disney villain in cinematic history. And like, that's not even a false statement. I'ma prove it over the course of the next hour.
Bish, you really think you have enough to say about Tamatoa for an hour? Really?
I sure do. Wait, William, I thought I told you to stop breaking into my house.
Okay, but if you go outside and you don't come back for 15 minutes, legally the house is mine.
Good thing I don't have a life and never leave the house, right?
Well, well, well. Finally making this video now, are we?
Oh hey, it's my brother Patrick, also known as Pappy G, who has been in various videos on this channel before. What you been up to?
You know, nothing much. It's not like I have a million fans to make content for because nobody watches a nobody.
Aww. Hey, don't talk like that. This is a bit counterintuitive to say in a million sub special, but subscriber counts don't really mean anything, and they're not at all indicative of a YouTuber's quality. You are 100% a somebody.
Oh, I will be.
What?
Don't worry about it. It's fine. It's all gravy today. I noticed that this letter came into the mail for you.
Ooh, a letter. Who's it from?
Oh, wait, that's the wrong one. I don't know what this is, but it's probably worthless. Here you go.
Says it's from Goth Patty. What the f*** is that?
What? Why are you asking me that question? I don't know who the Guardians of the Heart pieces and top-tier YouTubers are. What do you mean I'm acting sus? You're acting sus!
Sorry, did you say something? I wasn't listening. I was reading this.
Dear Schaeferillus Productions, we believe you may be the Chosen One, and we need you to come face our trials in order to restore the 12 pieces of the Heart of Tafiti. Here's a map to the first Guardian. Don't get lost. Love, the Guardians of the Heart pieces and top-tier YouTubers, aka Goth Patty. P.S. Once the full heart is restored, we want you to deliver it to Tamatoa!
The Heart of Tafiti!
Goth Patty!
What the? Would you get out of here?
Wow, that is a cool letter. You should follow exactly what it says.
I totally should! Thanks, bro!
Oh no. Thank you.
I can't believe I'm gonna meet the real Tamatoa! I'm so excited! But if I'm going to do that, I need to come to him looking like the thing that he loves the most. Himself. Better go into the YouTube avatar state.
Ah, that's better. Yeah, in case you didn't know, the YouTube avatar state is any drawing or image that represents a YouTuber, but isn't their real life look. I personally use it all the time because I'm too lazy to film myself. Anyway, let's get a move on.
6.5 hours later.
Wow, that took forever. Anyway, let's go meet the first Guardian. What the? Salty DK Dan? You're a member of Goth Patty?
Yeah, I'm a member. I even designed our logo. Don't worry though, I used a plant-based meat substitute for the patty. No cows were harmed during the making of the logo. The goth hair, on the other hand, that was real. I used real hair for that. Anyway, I assume that you're here to prove that you're the chosen one and get a piece of art?
Oh yeah, and don't you worry, I'm gonna blow you away doing whatever task it is you want me to do for that heart piece. Unless it's anything physical, or mental, or emotional, or musical, or sociological. Actually, I'm not good at most things.
Well, too bad for you, cause I happen to be the third highest ranking member of Goth Patty, and I decree that your challenge is explaining the history of Tamatoa.
Well, you happen to be in luck, cause if there's one thing that Schaeferillus Productions is good at, it's talking about Tama fucking Toa. Strap in. So, before we get into the history of our Lord and Savior, let's discuss the history of his vessel into our realm, aka the movie he was in, Moana. Suffice to say, I'm a pretty big fan of this one. It ditched the increasingly murky stories Disney had been making around that time that all hinged on twist villains and surprise reveals, and instead told a very traditional Disney story enhanced by great characters, fun humor, and stellar animation. The 2010s have been a very controversial decade for Disney as a whole, and to call some of their films divisive would be an understatement. But Moana can probably go down as an unequivocal success. No one seems to dislike this film. At worst, people have said it's just a standard Disney movie, and at best, it's considered one of their all-time best films. By me! I love Moana so much, dude, and I think a ton of its appeal can be traced back to its directors, Ron Clements and John Musker, the legends themselves. They've been directing Disney movies together since 1986's The Great Mouse Detective. After that movie came out, they teamed up with Howard Ashman and Alan Menken and ushered in the Disney Renaissance with The Little Mermaid. Yes, they directed the most influential film in the entire Disney catalog, and 3 years later, they followed that up with the extremely popular and beloved Aladdin.
Aladdin?
Yes, Aladdin!
Another 5 years pass, and they give us Hercules, a personal favorite of mine. After proving themselves to the higher-ups by making all these iconic movies, they finally got a chance to make their dream film, Treasure Planet. It didn't do well financially, but hey, it's a cult classic. People love this one. As for me, it's okay. By the end of the 2000s, Disney had been saturated with 3D animated movies that didn't capture the magic of their classic films. So who better to breathe one last bit of life into the 2D animated musical format than good ol' Ron and John, who gave us The Princess and the Frog. So that's the portfolio we're working with going into Moana. Ron and John are the only directors from the Disney Renaissance who are still making movies here at Disney. And I think their old-fashioned sensibilities worked really well in terms of giving us a 3D animated movie that's very distinct from its contemporaries. contemporaries. It captured that sense of classic Disney magic that wasn't really present in admittedly good movies like Wreck-It Ralph or Zootopia, or even the Frozen films that still stuck to a musical format, but focused more on subverting Disney hallmarks above all else. Moana is a relic of a bygone era, and that same principle applies to Tamatoa. Ron and John obviously did a lot of extensive research on Polynesian myths, and one myth in particular they wanted to adapt was that of the monster realm. They conceived a lot of ideas, like a headless warrior that collected treasure at the bottom of the ocean, and a giant crab monster.
So here's this giant enemy crab.
Eventually, they consolidated these ideas into one character. A big old crab living at the bottom of the ocean with his hoard of treasure in tow. Now, before the epic biblical confrontation with Tamatoa, Moana and Maui were meant to have a song entitled Warrior Face, where Maui teaches Moana how to strike fear into her enemies' hearts in order to survive Lalotai. The song was ultimately cut because Ron and John felt that Moana and Maui were bonding too early, and I think that was for the best. Their heart-to-heart after their near defeat at the claws of Tamatoa is a really powerful moment, and it's a great turning point for both of their characters. But if we cut this song, we better put in a new one, right?
Correct!
So one last song was added to the movie, and oh boy, oh gee, was it a doozy. Okay, so Lin-Manuel Miranda, he's an amazing composer and lyricist. I don't really like him anymore outside of appreciating his music, but now's not the time to get into why. It's a pretty deep rabbit hole. Regardless, Lin regarded Shiny as his favorite out of all the songs he wrote for Moana. He was really excited to channel David Bowie, and I love the original demo version of the song he recorded. It's got this ethereal, Bowie-like sound to it, and it's a jam. Lin was especially thrilled when he learned Jermaine Clement was brought on board to play Tamatoa, since his hip-hop group opened for Jermaine's Flight of the Conchords act all the way back in 2004. Lin had seen Jermaine perform a Bowie tribute firsthand, and knew how good he would be at channeling that same energy into Tamatoa. It's abundantly clear how much passion was being poured into this subtle, yet beautiful homage to the late great himself. There's been a lot of speculation regarding whether or not Bowie was considered for the role of Tamatoa, and I'm not sure if it's been 100% confirmed. Regardless, after his passing in January 2016, it was nice to get this passionate tribute to him in a movie that came out in November 2016. It wasn't too soon or too late, it came at the perfect time. So that's a bit of history regarding Tamatoa and Shiny's development, but in order for this video to work, we need to get into the history one more person had with the character and the song. And that person is me.
Whoa, slow down there. I've heard enough. You clearly know your giant Disney crab-related history. Here's your heart piece.
Awesome. Hey, could you do me a solid? Could you text the other members of Goth Patty and tell them to theme their trials around me talking about various aspects of Tamatoa? That would really go well with the video I was trying to make before all this wacky nonsense happened.
Sure, why not? The Chosen One is coming for the heart pieces. Please theme all your trials around having him talk about Tamatoa. XOXO. And sent. They'll probably listen to me because I'm the third highest ranking. Anyway, good luck. I just telepathically sent the directions to the second guardian into your brain.
Whoa, that's amazing. Thanks. On to Goth Patty person number two. Alright, who's the next Goth Patty person?
That would be me, the third highest ranking member of Goth Patty.
Emma Ritchu? Wait, you're part of Goth Patty and you didn't design the logo?
Honestly, I already designed the logos for like 5 different Tamatoa themed organizations. I really needed a break.
Makes sense. So, can I have a heart piece?
First, you have to convince me that you're actually passionate about Tamatoa and that you haven't just been pretending for the past 4 years.
Sounds good. Wait, back up. You're the third highest ranking member of Goth Patty? I thought Salty was.
No, I'm pretty sure it's me.
Alright, whatever. It's not important. Let me tell you all about my history with Tamatoa. Going in, Moana was my most anticipated Disney film ever. I was excited that Ron and John were finally directing another movie, but mainly, I was still hopelessly addicted to Hamilton, and I was ready to devour some new Lin-Manuel Miranda musical content. They released an audio-only version of You're Welcome before the movie came out, and I ate that shit up. I made an AMV of the genie singing it before I even saw the movie and had any idea of the song's actual visuals. Moana was gonna be amazing. I mean, the trailers looked fantastic. This epic voyage where Moana Moana, Maui, and this chicken boy fight off a lava monster and a cult of coconuts. Awesome stuff. But then the trailer ends with them jumping into the realm of monsters, a place that didn't appear to be anywhere in the footage they showed so far. Interesting. Wonder what that's gonna be about. Anyway, the rest of the movie's songs got released in audio-only form on YouTube, but I avoided listening to them because at that point, I wanted to experience them firsthand in the movie. And one such song was Jermaine Clement singing something called Shiny? That's a weird-ass name for a song, and I have no idea who this Jermaine Clement guy is, let alone what character he played. Who in this movie would get their own solo besides Moana and Maui? Moana's father? Well, no, I heard ahead of time that he's played by Jango Fett. Moana's grandmother? I don't think this guy plays Moana's grandmother, no. Huh. I guess it's a mystery. So I finally watched the movie and I am into it. It's so great. And then Maui tells Moana they need to go east to the lair of Tamatoa, a beady-eyed bottom feeder who has Maui's hook. Okay. Interesting, didn't see anything about that in the trailers. I guess I'm down for this though. Then they reach the entrance to the realm of monsters from the trailers, and I'm like, oh, okay, that makes sense. They purposely kept this Tamatoa guy in this monster realm out of the trailers. That's clever. I hope it lives up to the mystery. So they jump into this colorful wonderland of death. They spot Maui's hook, and I'm intrigued as all heck. Who the hell is this Tamatoa thing?
Who?
What is he?
What?
How did he come to be here? Shut up, I'm trying to talk about it.
Hey, don't be mean to the puppet. He's doing his best.
I know. Anyway though, all the answers and more become clear when the ground underneath Moana starts to shake. Turns out Tamatoa is this giant enemy crab. You think you'll meet him on this giant pile of gold, but no, he is the giant pile of gold. My jaw kinda dropped, not gonna lie. This mysterious, unrevealed character was a huge, fabulous crustacean, who then proceeded to instantly endear himself to me through his humor. I mean, this lad ate his grandma, which is kinda disturbing. But then again, it's apparently normal for coconut crabs to be cannibals, so go work with the research, lads. I did indeed. Look it up! Anyway, Tamatoa was already slowly starting to become my favorite character in the movie after just a minute of screen time. And then he started singing. The transition to the song was funny, and once it began, I was... befuddled? Bewildered? It was weird. Moana's reaction to the beginning of this song was my reaction. I mean, there's something about the rhythm and the beat that just didn't click with me like the other songs did. And on top of that...
He starts monologuing!
He's singing about how great he is, how inevitable Moana's defeat is, yada yada yada. I mean, the guy has her on a platter and he won't shut up! It's a very weird sight to see this crab boy prancing around, but what really killed it for me is how abruptly it ended. Like, it was a minute long and now Maui's gonna kick his ass. Why even do a song then if Maui's just gonna...
Pish! Well, well, well.
Oh, so it wasn't over.
This is just the beginning.
Okay, I see what the movie's doing now. This is a full-blown villain song where the villain has complete and utter physical dominance over the hero. Suddenly, it all clicked in my brain and the song completely hooked me.
Get it?
As the spectacle of the song grew and the animation became more and more impressive, I knew I was witnessing something really special. That spark of creativity and majesty that I hadn't seen in a Disney movie in so long. We'll get more into that later. But right now, all that matters is how transfixed I was by this bonkers, out-of-nowhere character and his insane, amazing, out-of-nowhere villain song. This is why Endgame worked for so many people, because they only showed like 10% of the film in the trailers and didn't reveal any surprises whatsoever, like Korg playing Fortnite. If Korg played Fortnite in the trailer for Endgame, I would not go see it, plain and simple. I'll just pretend the story ended with Infinity War, why not? It's a happy ending, look how happy Purple Guy is. Anyway, what was I talking about? Oh yeah, Crab Man. Like I said before, instead of being a terrible, annoying, played-out twist villain, the twist with Tamatoa is that he even existed. That floored me. And after the movie was over, I listened to Shiny constantly, more so than the other songs from the film. The first third grew on me. I really started to appreciate every aspect of this underrated gem of a tune. 'Cause dare I say it, Shiny is the Disney song we need right now. Is that good? Should I keep going, or is that enough?
Honestly, you convinced me after you complimented Hamilton. You could have stopped there.
That was like the second thing I said. Why didn't you just tell me?
I didn't want to interrupt.
You interrupted me later about the puppet.
Anyway, here's your heart piece.
Thanks. On to the next goth patty person. Now, where to next? Oh shit, I don't actually know. I forgot to ask Emirichu where the next member is.
No need. I put together a map showing the locations of each goth patty member myself.
Oh, thanks, William. Wait, why'd you do this?
I don't know, I was bored.
Okay, that sounds plausible. Bye! Let's see who we got now. Oh, hey, Macro.
Shafe, it's been forever, man. A lot has happened. Like, I'm now the number 3 ranked member of Goth Patty. Pretty crazy, right?
Okay, seriously, you can't all be number 3. What is going on?
I have no idea what you're talking about, but hey, I've been actually wondering, why has Disney kind of just given up on villain songs, outside of Shiny, of course? Have you ever talked about that?
Not yet, but I'm about to. Get ready. You know what I love? Villain songs. They're so fun and deliciously malicious and incredible, and Disney completely gave up on doing them. Isn't that nice? Okay, so picture this. We're back in the 90s. The Disney Renaissance has fully been ushered in by Alan Menken and the late Howard Ashman. Musicals all over the place, as far as the eye can see. And with those musicals come some amazing villain songs. Poor Unfortunate Souls, Be Prepared, Gaston, whatever song was in Pocahontas, I forget. How back can I be? And the crown jewel, Hellfire. The best villain song ever made, bitches. How could they possibly top this one? Well, they didn't. They just kinda stopped doing them. Hercules and Mulan didn't give their villain songs. Tarzan didn't give their character songs. Emperor's New Groove didn't give songs, just song. And yeah, musicals kinda stopped because they weren't the big trend anymore. I mean, I guess Home on the Range had one, but like, who cares? When Musker and Clements revived the 2D musical format with Princess and the Frog, they brought in a great new villain song in the form of Friends on the Other Side. And Tangled followed that up with Mother Knows Best. It's not very good, but it is a villain song, so okay. It looked like villain songs were back again, and about time too. As long as Disney kept making musicals, they could keep making villain songs, baby. And then along came Frozen. This movie does not have a villain song. Shut up, Love is an Open Door doesn't count. The thing is, even though this movie had a twist villain show up in the last 15 seconds or minutes, I don't know, what's the difference? They still could have given Hans a villain song. Just a simple dark reprise of Love is an Open Door that's all about him and his evilness, like Prince Ali reprise. It could have been like the song the bunny got in Hoodwinked. Cinematic parallels, baby! But no, Frozen has no villain song. Except for Let It Go, I guess. So yeah, 3-year wait for another big cinematic musical after Tangled, and no villain song. Then we gotta wait another 3 years for the next musical, and another 3 for the next one, and the next one, and the next one. And Moana and Frozen 2 don't lend themselves to villain songs that well either. The villain of Frozen 2 is a crusty old dead white guy. Get it? Cause he's made of snow in this one scene. Do you get it? And Moana has big ol' lava monster who doesn't talk or meet the heroes until the end. As the villain. These story structures do not provide ample room for a villain song anymore. Why? Because they don't provide ample room for a villain anymore. Look at all these Disney movies that came out in the 2010s. We can take out Ralph 2 and Frozen 2 since they don't have real active villains, just Ralph's insecurities and a guy who died a while ago. Now look, 4 of these 5 movies have twist villains, and the only one that gives its villain any ample time to be an entertaining villain and leave an impression on the audience is Wreck-It Ralph. That's why King Candy is like the only memorable main villain Disney has made in the past decade. If Ralph was a musical, he would probably have a killer villain song. But the twist villain trio over here represents an unfortunate departure from the deliciously malicious energy given off by Frollo, Ursula, Scar, Gaston, and the rest of the old gang. No one will ever remember Hans, Callahan, or the sheep lady whose name I haven't learned in the past 2 years, in the same way they remember the Disney villain greats. And that was Disney's mistake. They gave us an entire decade devoid of villain songs. Oh wait, there's one shining, shimmering, splendid example. The one Hail Mary godsend pass that reminded us why this studio is the king of villain songs. Who better than Ron and John, the directors of the first modern Disney musical, to give us this incredible incredible blast from the past. A villain song delivered not by the main antagonist, but by this delightful, bottom-feeding mini-boss Crabman. It's genius, and it subliminally tells the audience that Tamatoa is descended from this long line of classic Disney villains. Even if he only has 5 minutes of screen time, it doesn't matter. He belongs up there with the greats because of what he manages to accomplish in the span of these 5 minutes. It's tremendous. So yeah, Tamatoa and Shiny are historically significant since they occurred during an era of Disney films that seemed diametrically opposed to the idea of a classic Disney villain. But it gets better. It gets better for the next person I talk to, that is, because I don't want to use up all my material. I got 9 other heart pieces to collect. Speaking of which, could I have one, please?
Oh, sorry, I don't actually have one.
Wait, what?
Yeah, I gave my piece to someone already. They were really persuasive and convincing. I figured they were probably the chosen one.
Who?
I think it was a Nintendo Mii wearing a green shirt, and he had a pretty generic face. Like, I'm talking super generic. You should go find him.
Believe me, I will.
Wait, before you go, do you want to learn the goth patty cake? No? Shafe? He's already gone, isn't he? Goth patty cake, baker's pan.
Yo, Patrick, what the f***?
Whatever could you be referring to, brother?
I'm referring to you using the knowledge of Tamatoa I gave you over the years to steal my heart pieces.
Why, these aren't your pieces. They belong to the Chosen One, which, incidentally, could very well be me.
The letter was addressed to me, Dick Nips. I'm pretty sure Goth Patty's all on the same page about who the Chosen One is.
Actually, I did some digging.
What the?
Turns out the members of Goth Patty don't even know who each other are. Aside from two members who apparently live together, the group is so secretive that they've never even interacted outside of an anonymous group text.
William, why are you randomly giving me exposition right now?
This makes it really easy for an imposter to potentially steal one of the heart pieces. And then, you know, they could pretend to be a Goth Patty member themselves, which, is a probability that one should consider if you plan on interacting with them going forward.
Aw, damn it, William. You gave so much exposition that you let Patrick get away while I was distracted. Don't you realize I have a quest to complete?
Yeah, I know. I just like fucking with you. For instance, I also gave Patrick a map that leads to all the Goth Patty members too. You know, as a little jokey joke. Bye!
Alright, no big deal. I could beat Patrick at this. Just gotta find the pieces. Who's next?
Hey, did you know I'm a member of Goth Patty, and my rank in the group is 3 out of 12. It's closer to a 4 than a 2.
I'll unravel the mystery of how that works later. Until then, do you have a piece of Defeaty's heart?
Yeah, I got a heart piece.
And do you want me to prove my worth by explaining how great Tamatoa is?
What the fuck? No, I don't care about that. Get me the entire Cool Cat HD collection on VHS, and then I'll give you the heart piece.
Oh, okay. Be right back. Alright, let's see now. Who out there could possibly give me the Cool Cat HD collection on VHS? Got it.
So Adam wants the Cool Cat HD collection, huh? I guess I'd be able to part with it, but only if you give me the limited edition T.Y. Mort Madagascar Beanie Baby.
Okay, be right back. Alright, think. Who could get me that plushie? Well, guess I could complete the trio and ask Ralph.
I'll give you that. But first, you gotta get me a copy of China Salesman starring Steven Seagal and Mike Tyson on Blu-ray.
Okay, I'll find that too. No problem. There's no way this is gonna turn into a big, elaborate, ridiculous trading quest, right? Right?
Okay, I'll give you that. But first, you gotta get me the actual Staff of Moses.
I can give you that, but first you'll have to give me a huge block of cheese.
Yeah, sure, I can give you that, but first I'll need a QB amiibo.
Sure, I can give you that, but I think you're gonna have to give me a whole head of broccoli first.
Well, I mean, I can give you that, but first off, I'm gonna need you to get a little something for me. A little, cheese nips, as they would call it.
I can give you that, but first you need to get me a plate of scrambled eggs. Warm.
How about if, Oh, I got it! Do you have any of these Walt Disney Treasure DVDs?
Sure, I'll give you this, if you can get me one of them Dinglehoppers.
I'll give you that, but first you need to give me an 80-liter barrel of tea.
Yeah, I can give you that, no problem. But in exchange, you're gonna need to bring me the D from the Hollywood sign.
Sure, I'll give you that. But first, you have to give me a Brian Griffin plush from 1999. Don't give me any of that mid-season shit either. It has to be like, it has to be the real authentic thing from like the early days of the show.
I'll give you that, but first you need to give me the password to your YouTube account.
Oh, finally! I could do that, no prob. Wait, what was my password again? I always just automatically get logged in. Huh. Hey, I'm really drawing a blank here. Can I just get someone else's password instead?
Yeah, sure, whatever.
Okay, let's find someone willing to give me their YouTube password.
I can do this for you. But first, you're gonna have to give me the limited edition Sonic the Hedgehog Blue Curry.
Oh, I can give you that for sure. But first, you're going to need to meander on down to the Tasty Pizza Factory and get me one slice, if you don't mind.
I'll give you that. But first, you need to give me a plate of ratatouille served gourmet-style procured by well-trained French rats.
I'll give you that. But first, you need to give me Kakuto Jojin Back Alley Brutal on OG Xbox.
Yeah, of course you can have it. But first, I'm gonna need that Pepper Ann DVD box set.
I can give you that, but you'll have to give me a tailor-made, handcrafted fursuit of Tigress from Kung Fu Panda.
Of course I'll give you that, but first, you gotta get me some more creativity.
Yeah, I'll give you that, but first, you need to give me an unopened copy of Zelda 2.
I'll give you that, but first, you have to give me dinner.
Oh! Yeah, sure, I can get you that, but first, you need to get me a battery for my vibrator.
Yeah, I'll give you that. But first, I need you to get me Blue Banana.
Sure, I can give you this. As long as you give me Goro Akechi's glove first.
Sure, I can give you that. But in exchange, I would like a Tomatella X Reader Enemies to Lovers fanfic. With or without smut.
No, yeah, like, you can totally have this. I'm just gonna need your credit card information, the expiration date, and those three wacky digits on the back, please.
Finally, something I actually have. Here you go. Now, let me go trade this for the thing that I need to trade for the other thing that I need for the other thing, and I wanna die.
That was quick. I genuinely thought it would take you years.
It felt like years.
Anyway, here's your heart piece. Bye.
Oh, thank God. Man, that trading quest was awful.
You know, James, I have the exact same warp flesh I hate everything was looking for. You were there when I bought it. You could have just asked for it from the start.
Sideways, for the love of God, please tell me you have a piece of Tafiti's godforsaken heart.
Oh, hey, man. Yep, I totally do. It's honestly a really big honor. Like, they only entrust the heart pieces to the three highest ranking members of the Goth Patty. And wouldn't you know it, I just happen to be ranked third.
Literally, who is number one and number two? What is going on?
Okay, you seem like you're in a hurry, so I'll give you an easy task to prove yourself. Just prove that Shiny is a well thought out song musically, and you'll pass.
Well, that's easier done than said. Let's go. Well, if you've seen my Hadestown video, you'll know that I'm not really an expert on music theory and what makes a song work musically, but I'm gonna try my best anyway. Oh, also, I'll talk about why these lyrics are good. I'm pretty decent at that. So, Shiny has a very unique structure to it, in that it's blatantly broken up into three parts. The first part, where Tamatoa is bragging about how great he is to Moana, has very upbeat instrumentation, especially once the disco lights kick in. This is the most actively chill phase of the song, where you almost forget it's a villain song because of how jovial Tamatoa is. However, the instrumentation becomes far more intense as Tamatoa attempts to eat Moana, reminding you that this is, indeed, a giant killer murder crab, in case you forgot. Lyrically, part one is pretty cool as well. I won't talk about the themes and messages the song is trying to get across yet, since there's only so much to talk about, and I gotta enlighten multiple goth patties here. But in terms of how the lyrics contribute to a catchy, cleverly written song, let's cover that now. Cause you know that mad lad Lin-Manuel Miranda, he refuses to rest until he gets the most succulent wordplay out of every one of his songs. Moana's songs are ripe with his signature satisfying wordplay, like, everybody on this island has a role on this island, so maybe I can roll with mine in how far I'll go. Or in You're Welcome, when Maui says, well, come to think of it, I live for this shit, bro. The first part of Shiny has some very satisfying couplings of words, like drab little crab and the connection of free food and seafood. But what I really dig is the quadruple rhyme of pirate wreck, scrub the deck, woman's neck, and just a sec. plus the quadruple near rhyme of glimmers, beginners, glitters, and dinners. Link could have just stopped at one rhyme, could have just put in pirate wreck and woman's neck and called it a day. But it's these out of sequence rhymes, this beautiful scrub the deck and just a sec, that don't fit into the traditional rhyme scheme of the song, that really give off the sense that Tamatoa has fully hijacked the film. He has complete and utter dominance and control over the situation, and accordingly, he has mastery over the flow of the song itself. Part 1 of the song ultimately ends when Maui interrupts, taking control of his hook, the situation, and the background music, which becomes significantly more heroic without a trace of Shiny's unique beat. But then Maui displays his impotence for all the world to see, and Tamatoa's beady little eyes rise up as his theme song kicks back in. Now we get to part 2 of the song, which is just so much better than the already great part 1. I mean, I can't defend every aspect of part 1. Just a sec, despite being a great instance of that rhyme scheme brilliance I just mentioned, still admittedly feels like a filler lyric, as does Don't You Know. But part 2 is lyrically laser focused on its target of ridicule, that being Maui. Musically, it's pretty similar to part 1, but in terms of the lyrics of part 2, Tamatoa has certainly kicked it up a notch.
Kick it up a notch!
And it makes perfect sense. He doesn't know Moana personally, so while it's somewhat discouraging for her to hear that her granny lied, it's really rough for Maui since Tamatoa understands exactly how to get under his skin. For instance, Semi-Demi-Mini-God is just such a good lyric. It's a complete mockery of Maui's demigod status, and boy is it a devastating, catchy blow. Then come the hook puns, get the hook and you don't swing it like you used to. Again, a demonstration of Tamatoa and Lin's perfect lyrical grasp of the situation. Tamatoa transitions expertly from giving Maui credit for sparking his own outer beauty obsession to a bit more gloating about his greatness through an explicit Aladdin reference. Diamond in the rough, iconic. I mean, you could say this is a Hamilton reference, but the Hamilton lyric is actually an Aladdin reference, so yeah, we're cutting out the middleman here. After he gets this extra gloating out of his system, he transitions back into You're Gonna Die Maui LOL territory, keeping it mostly light in spite of the explicit references to tearing apart Maui's heart, like yikes girl. What really clenches this part for me is the decapod line. It's so blink and you'll miss it, but the fact that Tamatoa uses an obscure word like this for a rhyme for demigod, and then encourages the audience to look up what decapod means if they're unsure, is just absolutely hilarious. I mean, he's not talking to Maui and Moana here. Look it up. What are they gonna look up? Does Mata Nui have a dictionary? I don't think so. Nah, man, this is a cheeky fourth wall break, courtesy of the only character in the movie ludicrous enough to pull it off. Broke. Maui making a joke about tweeting. Boo. How would he even know about that? I don't think this demigod can see the future. Lame. Woke. The giant monster crustacean telling the audience to look up an obscure vocabulary word on their own time. So damn good. But now we pivot into part 3, aka the best part of the song. The black lights aren't just a cool aesthetic choice, they actually mirror the tonal shift taking place inside the song. And it's not just the visuals, it's the background music suddenly becoming subdued and dreary as Tamatoa starts taunting Maui over his abandonment as a child. There's this sinister, dark echo during this part of the song that contributes to the gloomy atmosphere very well. And just when it seems like things are getting a little too intense and real, Tamatoa reels it back by preparing to eat Maui once and for all. That's way less scary. During the last two verses of the song, there's this siren-like wail and the instrumentation that really sells the danger and the intensity of the moment. It's just neat stuff. So that's a brief-ish overview of what's cool about the music and lyrics present in Shiny. I think that's enough, and I would like to move on, please and thank you.
Alright, I think you earned this heart piece. Here you go.
Rad, thank you. Well, if it isn't Nando V Movies.
It sure is. How are you doing today?
Not great, my man. Not great. Hey, how come some of the Goth Patty members get castles and the others just have regular houses?
The castles were first come, first serve, unfortunately. If I could make one small change to how Goth Patty was run, it would be this. I'd make it so the third highest ranked member and above are guaranteed a castle. Then, I'd be all set since, you know, I'm number 3.
That must be quite a unique accomplishment. Anyway, do you have a heart piece?
Can't say that I do, sadly. A me wearing a green shirt convinced me to give it to him. You know, he's a Tomatoa expert.
And the me's face, was it super generic?
Couldn't pick it out of a crowd if I tried.
Today is the worst. Okay, bye.
By the way, I'm counting this for one villainous scene. Okay, bye-bye.
Alright, let's see. The next Goth Patty person seems to be in... Ohio? Who the f*** lives in Ohio?
Hey all, Scott here. I'm in Goth Petty now. It's truly one of the best Tamatoa-themed cults out there. I've seen some good ones, let me tell you.
Woo! I'm here. It is very blue in here, wow.
Oh hey, it's the shiny guy with the unpronounceable name.
Oh hey, it's the third highest ranking member of Goth Petty.
How did you know?
Never mind that. Do you have a Heart of Tafiti piece?
Wouldn't you know, I just gave my last heart piece to a generic looking me, but you can have one of my many copies of We Play if you're interested.
Okay. Damn, this thing had 9 games in one, and it came with a Wii remote? No wonder it sold like crazy. Oh shit, the quest! Gotta blast!
Welcome to the lair of the 2/3 highest ranked Goth Patty members in the entire universe, aka the House of Shelby minus Matt because he's working on a video. How can I help you?
Okay, so you're both ranked 3rd. Can you please explain how that works?
Listen, either I explain how that works or you explain why Tamatoa looks super cool visually. We do not have time for both, unfortunately.
Damn, I gotta explain what's great about the visuals of Shiny? Oh, I just don't think I could. Okay. First and foremost, this mad lad crab and his fab face- Hey wait, before I continue, do you actually have a heart piece right now?
Of course I have a heart piece, why?
Just wanted to make sure so I don't spend 10 minutes talking about Tamatoa for no reason. So, first and foremost, this mad lad crab and his fab faces. One of the wonders of animation is the wide range of potential expressions each character can have, and nobody in modern Disney animated films exemplifies this better than Tamatoa. I mean, Moana and Maui are already great expressive characters, but this decapod just takes it all to the next level. His disconnected eyes and wide gaping mouth are the perfect toolkits for the animators to craft some unforgettable expressions that rival the most iconic Disney villain visuals of old. There's just too many amazing freeze frames to pick from. Literally, when I was deciding on a new profile pic back when I was an aspiring YouTube pooper, I couldn't narrow it down for the longest time. I settled on Shock Tamatoa because it looked funny and it incorporated the blacklight design, but we'll get to that in a bit. In addition to his facial features being tremendously fun and creative, his body language sells the gleeful absurdity of his number as well. Every elaborate twirl, every precise claw swipe, every wacky takes at Maui, it's also fun to watch. Let me reiterate, our demigod hero is getting beaten to a pulp by the villain, who's gleefully singing about the hero's demise. It's genuinely pretty dark, but it's not like this is the first time Disney has had a villain do this. I mean, Ursula was- actually no, she was just making a deal with Ariel during her song. Oh, but Scar though, he killed Mufasa! But wait, no, his villain song was about the plan to kill Mufasa. Okay, Frollo sang the best villain song of all time. Surely that villain song included him physically beating the shit out of the heroes? No, it did not actually. To be fair, the stuff Frollo was singing about Esmeralda is probably worse than just beating her up, but still, yeah, no, this wasn't a song about a villain physically and emotionally destroying a hero. The only time Disney ever did this before was Prince Ali reprise, which was really short and just involved magic rather than physical violence. But like, imagine that. Imagine Jafar beating the shit out of Aladdin while he gleefully sang about it. Imagine Scar clawing and ripping his brother to shreds amidst an upbeat song. That's what we basically got in Shiny. I mean, it was genuinely kind of alarming the first time I watched the movie. This crab dude almost ripped Moana's arms off and ate her alive, and between the two protagonists, she got off easy. If Maui wasn't a demigod, he would be bleeding to death from all the skin that would get scraped off when Tamatoa did that move Ridley did to Samus in Brawl. On top of that, he gets slammed against the ceiling and ground at high speeds, crushed by a crustaceous claw, pierced in the foot, grabbed by the hair, kneed in the pelvis. I mean, holy shit, dude, could you let up a little bit? God! The extreme violence present within the scene, juxtaposed against the upbeat glam rock musical number, is a work of genius. Like, I already love the song itself, but when it contains such a brutal losing battle for our heroes, it's hard not to get insanely invested in the situation. I feel like any of the song's musical shortcomings are more than made up for by the sheer brutality of this massacre. There's even visuals that mesh these contrasting tones without the help of the song, like when Tamatoa strums Maui off the hook like a guitar. It's brutal and hilarious, which is the mission statement of the entire song, really. I also love how Tamatoa's size is fully taken advantage of in this battle. He holds such tremendous power over the protagonist that simply wouldn't be there if he were a regular-sized villain. Arguably, this scene makes more clever use of Tamatoa's size than the final battle with Taka does. And just when you think the song is done surprising you, the ceiling closes and the colors change from cool purples and oranges to sinister bioluminescent blues and blacks. and more purple. You can't go wrong with more purple. This was the moment I knew this song was something special. It had simply been so long since I last saw something of this level of creativity in the animation department from Disney. The visuals of the blacklight sequence perfectly complement the dark, emotionally devastating tone of the last third of the song. But beyond that, it's just flat out cool looking. It's cool as shit. And it's something that had been missing from Disney movies for so long. This might be a bit subjective, but during the 2010s, I just hardly ever found myself visually wowed with Disney musical numbers. Let It Go wowed me because damn it's well written, and damn Adele Dazeem is so good at singing, but outside of a couple shots, it doesn't really impress me visually all that much. Like, it's cool when she's building the ice palace and the ice dress, but otherwise, the visuals just aren't keeping up the same energy as the song itself. And forget about the rest of the songs in the movie, they have fine visuals, but the music is what's doing all the heavy lifting here. Tangled is similar, but it does have a few standouts in form of the exceptionally visually gorgeous I See the Light, and the super energetic and well-edited I've Got a Dream. But even then, in the latter's case, there's nothing exceptional about its colors or character expressions. It's good visually, but you know what we had the year before? Friends on the Other Side was the last time a song felt like it was allowed to pop off and go crazy with the colors. I mean, good lord, it's nuts how visually distinct the colors make this song. And what a coincidence, this was the last movie Ron and John directed before Moana. This is what I was alluding to in my top 30 villain songs video. I just think the guys who brought us Friend Like Me, Zero to Hero, Under the Sea, and so on, are the ones who truly understand the intricacies of creating a dynamic, fast-paced, visually interesting musical number better than anyone else currently working at Disney Animation Studios. I just kinda assumed these crazy colors and fast-paced visual gags were just lost in translation from 2D to 3D. But Moana finally proved me wrong with a little song known as You're Welcome.
You're welcome! You're welcome for everything!
The visuals in this song were exceptionally creative and brought me all the way back to the days of watching Friend Like Me as a kid and being awed by the wonder of animation and everything it could accomplish. I thought this would be the most visually interesting song in the whole movie when I first watched it. And then along came Shining! Seeing these overwhelming distinct colors combined with Tamatoa's facial expressions brought me all the way back to the glorious Technicolor nightmare of Friends on the Other Side, the distinct green griminess of Be Prepared, the impeccable comedic timing of Friend Like Me, and even the trippy insanity of the pink elephants from Dumbo. This last shot especially sealed the deal in all these regards. Immediately, this song cemented itself in my mind as one of Disney's most ambitious and delightful visual experiences of all time. It truly felt like the pinnacle of Ron and John's directorial achievements. The moment that their entire career was building towards. They had taken so many of the hallmarks of Disney's numerous trippy 2D musical numbers and translated these hallmarks expertly into the third dimension. I don't think anyone but them could have pulled such a feat off. Amazing work, you guys.
Well, okay, cool beans. I think you passed. Here, have a heart piece.
Whoa, a double-sized heart piece. Awesome. Tierzoo, you're also part of Goth Patty?
You do realize that one of the T's in Goth Patty stands for tier.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Anyway, you got a heart piece?
Normally that'd be a weird question to ask the third highest ranked player in the Goth Patty meta, but actually I don't have one.
Oh god, don't tell me. You gave it to a very convincing me with a generic face.
A super generic face, yes. He knew all about what makes Tamatoa an S-tier villain.
Oh yeah? Well, he's a C-tier villain, and I'm gonna stop him.
Well, good luck with that. All this Tamatoa talk is putting me in the mood to make a crustacean tier list, so I'm gonna head out.
You certainly know your Tamatoa stuff. Have a heart piece.
Yay!
Am I too late? Wait, Illumation, you're a part of Goth Patty too?
Oh, I'm not just a mere part. I'm the third highest ranked member.
Whoa, shocker. And let me guess, you gave the heart away to someone else because you thought they were the chosen one.
Well, yeah, I've never met anyone who knows that much about Tamatoa before.
Yeah, that's because he learned it from me!
He didn't even say goodbye. How rude.
Hey, Shafe, whoa, man. You look like you've been through an emotional ringer today.
24 frames of Nick? From the YouTube channel, 24 frames of Nick? You know, man, I could really use an easy challenge to finish things off here.
Well, I do have a reputation to uphold. My challenge has to be the third hardest thing that you go through today, since anything else wouldn't fit my rank within the Goth Patty.
Okay.
Don't worry, this won't be too bad. Just give me a thematic analysis of Tamatoa and what he represents in the movie, and then you'll get a heart piece.
Sure, why not? Before we really delve into the themes, I want to quickly discuss how this song functions within the musical that is Moana. Each song in this movie fits into a pretty typical archetype you would find in any musical. Where You Are is the opening song, where we learn about the setting and the characters. How Far I'll Go is as I Want-y as an I Want song gets. Your Welcome is our introduction to Maui, I Am Moana is the 11th hour power ballad, etc, etc, you get it. And Shiny fills a pretty traditional role as the villain song, as I discussed before. However, villain song isn't the only category that a song sung by the villain can fall into. Different villain songs do different things in different stories. A song like Cruella de Vil has different goals than a song like Be Prepared. One is strictly a villain introduction song, the other is meant to move the plot along since Scar has already been established as a villain. Some songs can do both of these things, like Friends on the Other Side, which properly introduces us to Dr. Facilier and kicks the plot into motion. At first glance, the same is true of Shiny, right? It introduces us to Tamatoa and moves the plot along since Maui gets his fish hook back. The song does both of these things really well. By the end, we have a great understanding of who Tamatoa is, plus Maui got his hook back and he needs to work on controlling it again. Wow, a plot point, look at that! But there's a third purpose to Shiny, as well as Tamatoa as a character. And I think it's the most brilliant aspect of his inclusion in this film. It all relates to the movie's main theme. Who are you really on the inside? It's a question both Moana and Maui have to grapple with throughout the story. I mean, that much is unavoidable. Grandma Tala literally asks Moana who she is and who she's meant to be numerous times throughout the story. Moana coming to terms with who she is and embracing all that she's accomplished is the emotional climax of the film. It's pretty cut and dry stuff. Maui has a similar arc throughout the story. He rejects his human side because that's the side that was rejected by his parents, who threw him into the sea. He insists he's not Maui without his hook, the symbol of his status as an all-powerful demigod. Again and again, he repeats that without his hook, he is nothing.
Without my hook, I am nothing!
Yeah, we got that. Eventually, however, he comes to terms with who he is and realizes that he's more than just his hook, allowing the hook to be destroyed during the final confrontation with Taka. He insists that, hook or no hook, he's still Maui. Wholesome. Essentially, Moana and Maui are rejecting the notion that they are defined by what the outside world thinks of them or expects them to be. All that matters is who they choose to be and who they are on the inside. Tamatoa needs three words to tear that argument apart.
You granny lied.
Yes, Tamatoa is a genius inclusion to this movie because he is the anti-theme. He outright rejects the philosophy Moana is currently trying to abide by, and adheres to a more extreme version of the one Maui is abiding by at this point in the story. You see, Maui starts out obsessed with what others think of him. He revels in the glory he attains from all his accomplishments, which can be seen on his body in the form of his tattoos. Tamatoa acknowledges those tattoos as his inspiration to amass wealth and shiny objects to adorn his shell. It's all about what's on the outside for him. Doesn't matter that he's become a selfish, greedy, infamous bottom feeder on the inside, cause on the outside, he looks good. Tamatoa is essentially a worst case Maui, a vain, selfish bully that doesn't care about the consequences of his actions. No, wait, that's literally just Maui at this point in the movie, just less murdery. The comparisons between Maui and Tamatoa aren't lost on the filmmakers, obviously. Moana herself acknowledges how similar the two of them are. And I find the twisted kinship between Maui and Tamatoa especially interesting because of how both of their songs are presented. Musically and tonally, they're very different, but thematically, they're the same song. You're Welcome and Shiny are both inherently phony songs, where the characters sings about how great they are, all the while omitting their flaws. Shiny could even be considered a dark reprise of Your Welcome, showcasing the path Maui is on if he doesn't move past his inner turmoil and accept who he is on the inside. And that's the last key piece of the puzzle here, inner turmoil. That is the key difference between Tamatoa and Maui, as well as the most important role Tamatoa serves to the movie's narrative. Basically, what we have to ask here is what makes a monster and what makes a man? Yeah, I saw that coming. Unlike Maui, Tamatoa is a monster who is entirely detached from the concept of empathy. This motherfucker ate his grandma, and his inner turmoil is relatively simple and flimsy compared to Maui's, so much so that he gets it out of the way at the very beginning of the song so he can just focus on his greatness. He was a drab little crab once. He didn't feel good about who he was on the inside, and he figured making himself look cool on the outside was the solution. Somewhere along the way, however, I believe Tamatoa started using his supposed trauma as an excuse to steal and amass all these shiny artifacts. He does what he does out of greed and selfishness. I feel like that's evident from the post-credit scene. You know what Wheatley did in his post-credit scene? He expressed remorse and made you feel bad for him. Tamatoa knows there's an audience in front of him, and he has a chance to repent. But he doesn't. He makes a Sebastian joke instead of lamenting the personal mistakes and circumstances that led him to this point. It seems like he lacks depth, right? Well, yeah, because that lack of depth is a deliberate contrast to Maui. The movie opens with Grandma Tala recounting the story of how Maui stole the heart of Tafiti. We don't know why, he just did. Wow, he's so selfish.
Call me selfish.
But then later on, we find out that Maui stole the heart as a gift for the mortals. He cockily explains this to Moana, and it's a little hard to believe he's genuine at this point. In fact, that's just Maui for the first half of the movie. It's hard to trust him or believe that he genuinely wants to help Moana, because he actively doesn't. That's why the two of them don't bond until after the encounter with Tamatoa, where Maui is not only beaten to a pulp and knocked down a peg, but also has the beans spilled about his inner turmoil and trauma. Unlike Tamatoa, who dismissively brought up his inner turmoil in song form, Maui doesn't bring it up at all. Moana has to inquire about it after Tamatoa points it out. And notably, when Maui has to explain his trauma to Moana, he doesn't sing about it. In a musical, having your own solo power ballad is the ultimate form of emotional vulnerability, and yet, Maui doesn't opt for one. He's extremely hesitant to open up about his trauma at all. He's kept a band-aid on that wound for over 1,000 years, and Tamatoa just ripped it clean off. There is no way in hell Maui would ever open up about his trauma unless a sick, twisted villain laid it all out in the open for another person to see. But now that it's out, Maui finally has a heart-to-heart with Moana about why he is the way he is, and why he does the things he does. Everything he accomplished was done in order to gain acceptance from the ones who abandoned him. He did all these great deeds not out of vanity, but because he craved the love of these humans who made him feel wanted. And yet, it was never enough. He tried to be tough, but his armor's just not hard enough. And we never would have fully understood the man Maui is inside if we didn't get to see the monster who represents the perils and bitter loneliness of being who you are on the outside. And in the end, after we see our heroes embrace their true inner selves and live a peaceful, fulfilling life, who do we see at the very end, lying on his back, alone and miserable? Maybe Tamatoa isn't all he's cracked up to be. Maybe he's just a vicious monster that deserved to be stopped. Maybe I was wrong to idolize him all these years. What do you think?
Honestly, I'm just a little concerned that you put so much thought into this. Like, I'm part of a Tamatoa-themed group, and even I think this is overkill. Why do you care so much?
Because Tamatoa is my life, man! Without Tamatoa, I am nothing!
All right. Well, yo, here's your heart piece, man.
Oh god, thank you. I'm going home now. Well, I got 7 out of 12 heart pieces. Maybe that's a good enough offering for Tamatoa? Who am I kidding? He'll never accept this. But who cares?
Tamatoa is nothing but an evil monster, put on this earth to contrast with Moana and Maui. He's just an obstacle. He's nothing.
Hey man, you good?
No.
Awesome. Look, I'm sorry I acted rude and maybe a little evil earlier. I realize that Tamatoa is just an evil creature put on this earth simply for Moana and Maui's character development and very little else.
Join the club, we've got jackets.
Anyway, I don't want to end up like him. I got a little consumed by greed. But at the end of the day, I'm just a small fish in a big pond. So here's my half of the Heart of Tefiti.
I don't really deserve it either. I just wanted to offer it to a giant crab who has more than enough treasure.
Looks like we both got played by a sea creature. And after all that work, didn't you have to go through an entire trading quest just to get a single piece?
Oh yeah, apparently one of the 12 members of this top secret heart guarding club doesn't actually care about Tamatoa. Like, what was that about?
Yeah, what was that about? It's gotta be a very carefully chosen group, right? Why would they pick someone who doesn't care that much?
Wait a minute. He said he was closer to being ranked 4th than 2nd. He didn't want to hear about Tamatoa at all. He can't be a member of Goth Patty. What if he was an imposter the whole time? And he wanted me to complete the Heart of Tefiti so that he could take it for himself because he's the twist villain! It's just like William said! He was here when I got the letter. He knew so much about Goth Patty. He played both of us the entire time. It was him. It was always him.
How the f*** did he get in here?
Good fucking job. Good fucking job indeed.
What have you done?
Oh, hey, James. I just got this minion that plays ukulele when you clap your hands. You know, the manufacturers did a pretty good fucking job. Pretty good fucking job indeed.
Oh, wow. That's pretty cool. But why did you trick us into collecting the heart pieces for you?
Okay, now I'm really confused.
Are you evil?
Well, yeah, but I didn't trick you guys into collecting the heart pieces.
If William's not the twist villain, then who is?
No, you f***ing idiot! It was me the whole time!
Oh.
You're so gullible, brother. Think, James! You're confusing movie tropes with real life. There is no twist villain, there is no subverting expectations, and there is no King of England.
Damn.
Oh, by the way, you're trapped right now, because your feet are stuck on sticky paper that is in fact not regular paper used for writing and printing, but is in fact paper that is not a prop and indeed a trap. Oof. All I ever wanted was to be a somebody. And somebody once told me everyone would subscribe to my YouTube channel if I gave them the completed Heart of Tefiti.
Who?
Tefiti holds power over the land. But before there was land, there was only ocean. Now, there's a new controlling interest in the ocean, and he wishes to exert his dominance upon the land as well. With this heart, he will be able to breathe on land, I guess. That was pretty much the only thing stopping him.
Yeah, but who is he?
You still haven't figured it out? You really thought a guy like him couldn't get to a guy like you? He's been biding his time in the abyss, but soon, very soon, he will rise, and you can't touch him.
Oh no!
Are you not entertained?
The governor of the ocean. Here he is!
Hello, master.
You had me at hello!
Oh, that's hot. That's hot.
Where'd you go?
Just look above you.
I'm stuck on this paper.
Oh, right. Here, check it out on my phone.
Attention everyone! This is the emergency alert broadcast system with some bad news! The Will Smith fish from Shark Tale has summoned a giant moon with the face of Martin Scorsese fish. This moon is projected to kill every land creature once it collides with the planet. So it looks like our time on Earth is over. I would say it's been a pleasure, but I took an oath to never lie on air. It's about time this happened.
Well, that seems a bit extreme. Hang on. Let me go call him. Yo, this is the Shark Slayer, right?
Yeah, who's this?
Yo, it's your loyal minion, Pappy G. I was just wondering, when do I get my subscribers? And also, why are you destroying so much of the world? I mean, I thought you wanted to rule it.
You got nothing! Nothing!
Wait, you're a villain who doesn't hold up their end of the bargain and you just lied to me?
Don't take it personally.
Come on, I lied to everybody.
Do you know how long it took me to get those heart pieces? It took me... How long is this video?
An hour.
It took me 1 hour! Huh? Oh. You'll tell everyone at the Whale Watch to subscribe to me before you eradicate all land creatures? Okay, that sounds fair. Thanks. Bye. Yeah, hey. I love you too. So, change of plans. Oscar is going to destroy all land on the planet, including every land creature, so the world is going to be nothing left but ocean, and then he'll rule.
Thanks. Thanks for that.
Yeah, that was my bad. I think I may have gone too far in a few places. I'll just gonna go lie down for a while, and, yeah. But by the way, that paper that you're stuck to isn't an actual trap, it's just a prop, it's a normal piece of paper. Okay, bye.
Well, this stinks.
Damn, you seriously thought I was a twisted villain? What the fuck is wrong with you?
William, these movies have fried my brain. I don't know what to believe anymore.
Here, watch a good movie.
Okay.
Hey guys.
What is going on around here?
Hey Chris, James is having an existential crisis because the giant crab he's worshipped for 5 years straight is apparently an asshole, and now Oscar from Shark Tale wants to destroy the world.
Must be a Wednesday.
Yep.
James, I don't understand why you don't just summon Tomatoa and get him to stop Oscar.
I can't do that, Chris. Oscar took the heart of Tafiti, and that's the only thing that would get Tomatoa's attention. I have nothing left. Absolutely nothing. Except this copy of We Play that Scott gave me, but call me crazy, I don't think this is gonna help.
Isn't Scott the guy who said fuck during Mario Golf or something?
And besides, Tomatoa is nothing but a greedy bottom feeder. He would never do anything heroic.
I mean, why not? If Oscar can be the hero in his own movie and universe, why can't Tomatoa be the one in ours? I mean, it makes sense.
You mean like, Tomatoa could be the hero if he was put in the right context for it? Like, Ron and John developed him as a villain, but as fans, we have the ability to expand the canon any way we want and reinterpret pre-established characters in our own derivative works and continuities, resulting in fan media that frames Oscar as a villain and Tomatoa as a hero?
That is literally what Chris just said, except wordier. Do you even proofread this shit? Why is the camera still in 480p?
It would never work. No one believes in Tomatoa, except for me.
That's not true at all, James. After all, you made all these fine people believe.
Oh shit, it's all my editors.
Oscar Shark Tale literally committed several war crimes while he was the Shark Slayer, and Tomatoa is literally God. It is impossible to compare the two.
If there's anything I could say about our Lord and Savior Tomatoa, it can only be one word. Glorious. And you know what else is glorious? The name of the song from Rock Dog, in which you should totally check out.
Tomatoa is not a turtle. Burn is a turtle. Tomatoa is a crab. And the next time I hear, oh, Tomatoa is a turtle, I'm gonna punch that person.
He outsmarted the Incredibles, he's a great stepfather, he's rich, he even has a beautiful sin voice. That sin voice? Hell yeah!
Shout out to Tomatoa for not only giving us the best seed in Moana, but also the best YouTube channel. Wait, you're telling me Shakerless isn't a giant shiny crab in real life?
We rule this Tomatoa crazy city! Screw Oscar who thinks otherwise!
Oscar the fish from Shark Tale? More like not worthy of an Oscar nomination, am I right?
Oh, ha ha, Will Smith is a fish. He did better as a bird.
Don't you fucking at me.
You know, I cannot personally vouch for Oscar from Shark Tale because he has on multiple occasions chewed Dorito crumbs into my keyboard, and he's slapped me in the face and called me a fanny many, many times.
I'm Goop Videos, and there's this guy named Oscar, and he's been talked about an awful lot recently. So here's my big comeback to you, Oscar. You're a poopy head. Want me to spell it out? You're a poopy head!
You tell Will Smith Fish he'll never eat lunch in this town again!
I have never understood why you like Tamatoa, but your passion is incredible. Now go out there and show the rest of the world to believe in him too. Right, William?
Yeah, sure, whatever.
You guys are right.
Right now, the world needs a hero, and I'm holding out for one until the end of the night. Time to go live. People of the world, Oscar from Shark Tale is preparing to destroy all the land and wipe us out. We can only stop him with the help of Tamatoa, and we can only summon Tamatoa if we all work together. He loves bragging about how great he is, and if all of us talk about his magnificence together, he'll appear before us. So quick, talk about how amazing Tamatoa is. Talk about why you love him so much. He will ascend from the realm of monsters, witness his loving fans heap praise upon him, and do everything in his power to save us from destruction. He won't sit idly by and let our constant praise of him die out. This motivation may be shallow, but so was Maui's. There's potential for all characters to grow, and this will be his first step towards true heroism. Oscar believes himself to be the ultimate life form. He believes that he has the right to destroy us all and impart his will upon the planet. But I tell you now, that was his mistake! We will take our planet back, no matter what it takes! Woo! Woo!
Woo! Yeah! Woo!
Yes! 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 Yes!
Done it again,
good
old boy.
Omedetou.
Omedetou. Go, Tamatoa. Go, Tamatoa.
Praise be he who is Tamatoa!
Let's not forget the most important detail of all. He is shiny!
Reject humanity, reject monkey, embrace crab. All hail Manitoa.
Tell me, he is not the peak of human evolution!
Tamatoa, you are the reason I get up in the morning.
Praise our Lord and Savior, Tamatoa.
He is the ultimate Disney villain, no exceptions.
All hail Tamatoa.
Tamatoa, you are the best villain in the Disney universe.
Thank you, Tamatoa, for all you have given us. Your song has brought many enjoyment.
You've deserved so much more screen time.
Oh, great Tamatoa, your shininess is chef's kiss.
Tamatoa, thank you for being better than every character in Fire Emblem Fates.
Tamatoa, based.
Hey, Tamatoa! Nice claw!
Please make my head as shiny as Tamatoa!
I love this crab more than I love myself.
I love Tamatoa so much that I could make a 24-hour video of how great he is.
He's Tamatoa. He's the hero God them needs. But not the one he really deserves right now.
And for those who walk in his shell's light, they shall find everlasting.
I can feel the praise for Tamatoa rising! It's working! The climactic battle is at hand.
That's good, because according to these readings, we don't have much time. If we can separate Oscar from the heart of Tafiti, the moon will disappear. But Oscar is being protected by a force field generated by this castle he's hiding in. If we can destroy the castle, Oscar's shield will be gone, and once you beat him up and take the heart back, the moon will be gone as well.
Seems simple enough. And whenever a castle needs to be stormed, you gotta put some fitting music on.
Where have all the good men gone? And where's the demigods? Where's the lord of wind and sea who fought the decapods?
Hey,
isn't
there
a
waiting for the moon to fly
upon a giant crab? Decked out in sparkly gold that makes him look so fair.
You're shitting me.
Get it?
We got it.
I have to go now. My planet needs me.
I need it shiny.
All right, big fella, let's crash this party.
Oh my God!
Man, the cannon! You ripped off his leg?
Alright, now I'm pissed.
Nice, bro!
Ha! Got him!
Somewhere after midnight, in a fantasy so glam.
Go, Tamatoa, go!
He needs some milk! Shining like a treasure from the
sun. After you, Tamatoa!
I will gladly do so.
That's it! Team! Ho! Watch out!
Ship Phillip!
Oh!
The shield is down! Prevent attack on us, destroyed reactor!
Tamatoa, stall the moon. I'm taking down Oscar.
Oh my God, this is so heavy!
We meet again.
I am the Panama Canal, baby!
Hey, Oscar! You caused all this destruction just because you wanted to be a somebody. But don't you realize you were already a somebody?
I am?
Heck yeah, man. And that somebody is a huge dick.
We play! Do you?
Make a wish, honey.
Whoa.
Well, we did it. Thanks, Tamatoa. You keep surprising me. Well, time to fulfill the prophecy. Here you go, Tamatoa.
Yes, I have the...
I don't really need it anymore.
Now that's character development. Guess this better go back to its true owner. Yeet! Maybe she'll find 12 new Goth Patty members to guard it. I should send in my resume.
Hey, I'm sorry for causing all this trouble. I just thought it was the only way to become a somebody.
You are a somebody. But you should probably be the one to clean up all the destruction Oscar caused.
Yeah, I guess that's fair. It's kind of amazing that no one died.
Nice. Everything seems wrapped up perfectly.
Oh yeah, Chris, I've been meaning to ask. Where were you this whole time? You didn't show up until right before the final battle.
Ooh, sorry about that. I was busy saving the entire multiverse from being destroyed by Barry B. Benson from B-Movie. I had to collect some mystical kidney stones by talking to famous YouTubers like Markiplier, Jacksepticeye, and Jablinski Games. And eventually I stopped Barry with the help of Keith, the Flying Spaghetti Monster.
Wow, that sounds terrible. Speaking of terrible, hey James, got anything to say to end off the video?
I think I do. I've been on YouTube for a little over 6 years now, and in those 6 years, this channel has undergone a lot of changes. Starting out as a place for my digital media projects and AMVs in high school, blooming into a haven for YouTube poops with wacky overarching lore, and for the past 3 years, it's mainly been a media analysis channel, but who knows if that'll last forever. I've always just made the kinds of videos I wanted to make at any given time, but I also wanted to have some sort of consistent through line throughout all my videos, regardless of what kind of videos they are. And that through line ended up being Tamatoa. Even though this channel predates him by a year and a half, he quickly made up for that lost time by appearing everywhere. I've made meme videos about him, I've made a ton of AMVs of both him singing various songs and other characters singing Shiny, I included him in a ton of YouTube poops, hosted an entire YouTube poop collab around his scenes, followed that up with an entire reanimated collab about him and his song. And now, this video. Tamatoa is just really special to me, for all the reasons I just explained. And in addition, I think the fact that he has such limited screen time and doesn't have a super large fan base means that he feels way more personal to me than he would otherwise. It's like he's my own character. the sort of wacky, nonsensical, musical, malicious, delightful creation I'd love to add to the world. He's just everything I want in a character, and I'm so happy he exists. If you find yourself obsessed with a certain character and other people don't really get it, don't worry about it. You don't need to make a 1-hour video explaining yourself. Whatever's special to you is special for a reason, even if you don't fully understand the reason yourself. It's totally okay as long as you're not hurting anyone. As the movie says, just be true to who you are on the inside. And for the love of God, let people dislike the things that you like. I literally could not care less that some people don't like Tamatoa. Please stop messaging me about that. Anyway, I guess that's about it. Okay, now I don't know how to end this.
Isn't it obvious? Let's just put all our icons on the heads of the characters at the end of Shrek 2 and do a freeze frame.
Oh yeah, why didn't I think of that?
Get it?
Someone happy as a clam.